You're in the business of governance, governance of AI systems. Ultimately, this executive order, I feel, leaves a lot still yet to be ironed out when it comes to actual guardrails, actual benchmarks, actual, well, really auditing. How do you see this EO doing?
Thank you so much for having me here today. It truly is a historic moment, and I am reporting here live from DC. You know, this executive order was one of the most comprehensive and expansive commitments to responsible AI that we've seen from the federal government. And something that I've stated in the past is we need to be okay with adaptive policymaking, and that's what exactly what we are seeing at this moment in time. This EO is so comprehensive. I've barely made it through half of it right now. But this is a strong signal from the government that now it is not about just talking about responsible AI, but making sure that not only the US agencies, but also private sector is showing success against what those guardrails are. So, Carolyn, absolutely, this is a starting point. There's a lot to unpack in this executive order, but I think we are going to see ripple effects across the world with this historic executive order from the president and the vice president.
Navrina, of the 50% of the extensive EO that you have read, what's your biggest criticism of the final form? Where would you have liked to have seen the administration do more?
So, Ed, I think this goes back to we always want more, and especially as technologists, we want it to be precise. But I think let's focus on what is so great about this EO. I think this EO, think about it as not a rule of the law, but this is a work plan that is providing a very compressed timeline for U.S. agencies as well as the private sector to start not only defining what does good look like in terms of benchmarking and evaluation of these powerful AI systems, but also holding them accountable in a very short time frame to come up with a game plan as to how we are going to make sure that whatever is defined as good is actually adhered to. So two things that I would like to call out in the EO that we are very excited about is, first and foremost, creation of standards led by NIST, especially for benchmarking and auditing of artificial intelligence systems. We have about 270 days for NIST to actually start building a game plan for that. And then secondly, the United States government agencies, we are looking for the OMB guidance, which is going to come out any day, which is going to put further focus on how procurement of AI systems by U.S. government and the agencies happen. So I would say that right now we should be focusing on all the great things that are in this EO. And then, yes, there's lots more work ahead of us, and we're going to continuously see over the coming months more and more getting defined in terms of what is really possible.
NIST being the National Standards Strategy for Critical and Emerging Technology. Navrina, I'm interested that they're setting basically benchmarks, guidelines. Your company already is kind of a private sector addition that could be taken. Have you suddenly got a load of inbound from this? Because, well, you're helping companies basically build AI accountably.
Yes, Carolyn. So Credo AI is an AI governance platform that provides continuous oversight and accountability of artificial intelligence systems. I would say not only because of this executive action, but the need for trust, which is so critical as companies are adopting, building, using artificial intelligence at scale, that has really propelled and increased the need for Credo AI in the market as well. And I think just to underscore, in Credo AI, we are operationalizing what does good look like? These might come from standards like NIST, AI RMF, ISO standards. It could come from regulations like New York City Law Number 144. It can come from company policies or industry best practices. And Credo AI already has been at the front of it. So now I would say the companies as well as U.S. government agencies are really requiring Credo AI as a core platform that's going to enable trust with their consumers.
Navrina, in that light and in pursuit of a range of views, I want to ask you the same question I've asked all our guests in the last 24 hours. The main mechanism that the EO spells out and the Defense Procurement Act empowers them to do is to require makers of large language models to offer them up for government safety review before they are released to the wider public. If a startup's building an LLM, is that a good mechanism? Will that help the industry move forward?
I think that's a great question. I am concerned about regulatory capture, and I think we have to really focus on how do we bring this entire startup innovation ecosystem forward. And something that we are actively focused on at Credo AI, where executive orders as well as regulations are not a barrier for startups, especially not the well-capitalized startups, but it's an enabler for them. So in terms of that, what the EO is spelling out, that the foundation model providers have to provide test results to the government before releasing these models, especially for government use, I think it's a good step, but it's not comprehensive. And this is where I am encouraged to see more action in the coming months, where we are going to provide that oversight as well as benchmarking and testing requirements across the entire value chain. The foundation model developers, the application developers, the enterprises, and the consumers. So, you know, that's the ripple effect of this executive order that I'm really excited to see coming in the few months.